Hey, I'm here with Nut. Mm-hmm. He used to be a monk here. Yep. At Wat, what is this Wat called?
Called Wat Sing Muan.
Wat Sing Muan, in the middle of Luang Prabang.
Yes.
And basically we'll be talking about meditation in Lao and what it's like to meditate here in Luang Prabang.
Well, in here, it's like meditation is from... First, I have to say that different people define meditation in a different way, but in my opinion, meditation is all about awareness and concentration. That works for me. For example, let's say if you close your eyes, sit down and meditate, you definitely don't need to follow your thought. Like, let's say when you meditation, you open your mind and there will be lots of thoughts coming to your mind. So you just, well, even if you follow your thought, you have to know how to bring it back. So you have to realize that, okay, right now I'm sitting here, you know, concentrate on what I'm doing, you know, maybe focus on breathing, this kind of thing, and that works perfectly for me. So
there's, you can have different focuses, like you can have a breathing focus, mm-hmm. or you could have maybe a mantra focus or something like that.
Right.
But the main point of meditation, like in this tradition,
uh-huh.
is to develop the awareness and the concentration.
Exactly.
Awareness of what exactly?
You know, awareness of, how can I say it? Awareness of, you know, develop, like keeping your minds or thoughts aware that you will follow through those things. Like, you know, when you do meditation, or whatever you do, like, how can I say it? I don't know how to say the word. Like, you...
It's okay, no worries, just describe.
Like, you know, when you do meditation, like, or not,
mm-hmm.
your mind will always have something, you know, come through. And if you keep on following those thoughts or whatever, you will get, you know, messed up with many problems and many thoughts on your head. So to do meditation, that means you need to, you have to aware of those problems will harass into your mind.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
so to become aware of the thoughts yeah, that are the creating thoughts,
yeah.
the problems.
Yeah.
So exactly. The awareness is almost becoming more aware of your mind.
Yes, exactly. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
What about your body? Do you concentrate on your body? Do you feel that there's an awareness there?
When I do meditation, I not necessarily concentrate on my body because I can sit down like any posture, and that's fine for me. It doesn't have to be like sit cross-leg or whatever. But the main focus on for me is the mind and the thought. So yeah. So I need to make sure that I aware and realize that what I'm doing right now, you know, in a moment. So yeah.
Hmm. What you're doing right now with your mind?
With my mind, yeah.
Yeah.
Like not following. Let's say sometimes when I meditate, like I open my mind and then I kind of have a thought, like being maybe, you know, my thought is in America or in somewhere else.
Yeah.
And then, oh, that's too far, you know. And then I need to find a way to bring it back. Like, I mostly like focus on breathing, like exhales and inhales, or I count number one, number two, and that keeps me calm and concentration. So, yeah.
Cool. So, how did you learn this kind of meditation?
You know, when I first came into the temple, every temple we have a master or abbot who, you know, lead us to this process. So we first start by chanting. So chanting is one of meditation, when you chant, because we chant in Pali, it's not in Lao, like mm-hmm. We have to make sure that we are on a, you know, like when people sing songs together, like you have to be in a line, like how can I say, falls in lines together, like
sitting together,
yeah, something mm-hmm. like that. And then after the chanting, we did meditation, like first we start by 10 minutes and then 20 and 30 minutes.
Mm.
And the longest time that I can do is like 40 minutes, not an hour, it's too long for me.
What happens after 40 minutes for you?
You know, my body is very, you know, I have problem with my my knee and also my waist, something like
your hips, yeah.
Yeah. So I always change my position, like sometimes sometimes I sit like this, sometimes I cross legs, sometimes I just, you know, I kneel down. But you know, when you change your position, it's quite often it's also hard for your mind as well to, you know, to focus on, to concentrate.
So, In the tradition here, is it are you supposed to keep yourself still, or are you allowed to move around your body?
Actually, the old technique is we supposed to keep our body still, but right now, since different people find the meditation works in a different way, so people kind of know, no matter how you, you know, you manage your position of your body, as long as you keep on your mind focused on, you know, those things, that's fine.
Keep your mind focused on the awareness?
Yeah, awareness and concentration on of what you're doing in the present moment.
What you're doing in the present moment.
Yeah.
And okay, so cool. So I think that I have a good idea now of what your meditation is like.
Yeah.
It's very cool to see, you know, different kinds of meditations around the world, very similar, you know, that they all kind of focus on awareness in the present moment.
Yeah.
But one thing that really fascinates me and interests me is, you know, do you ever think about, like, why do we meditate, right?
Mm-hmm.
What's the goal? What's the point? You know, and I think different people have different goals, you know what I mean? Yeah,
goals.
So what do you think here? Did you ever get teachings about that, or maybe do you have an idea for yourself of why you meditate?
Well, actually, in here in Luang Prabang, every year we have 10 days retreat, like a meditation retreat, like all monks and novices in Luang Prabang go to the forest and do some meditation. So to meditate, that means, you know, everyday life, we have so many problems, like in 1 minute, like thousands of thoughts can harass your mind.
Mm-hmm.
And if you just keep on living with those problems coming and coming without stopping and without doing any meditation, at some point I think you will, you know, get frustrated and maybe angry for whatever reason is. So meditation is to relax, keep calm, concentrate on your thoughts again, and that's the main point.
Is basically for being able to be calm in this moment, not to get angry and frustrated.
Right.
So,
that's the main focus. But one of the things that why we do the meditation is to make yourself again, I forgot the word.
To make yourself, is it,
how do I say it? To make yourself, like,
aware, awake?
Awake and realize that what's in life, and, you know.
Yeah, to wake up.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay, like the Buddha, right?
Yeah,
Buddha means awakened one.
Yeah.
Yeah, so that's really the main focus of this documentary that we're working on, is what does that mean to be awake? And I know it's hard to define, right?
Exactly.
Yeah.
There are many different contexts. So in terms of Theravada Buddhism, to awaken is to realize, to be careful, to be aware of the problems or whatever you will have come across in your life. Like, since as human beings, we all have futures that we have to, you know, keep up and going to. So, kind of doing some awareness thing for yourself or for people around you.
So awakening is to become more aware.
Yeah.
To become more aware of your mind.
Either mind or behavior or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mind and behavior. So to become more aware of yourself.
Well, yeah, like a. So, what we learn here is like all like. Everything starts from the thought first, right? Mm-hmm. From the thought, and then we do the action, and lead to the next step, whatever it leads to be. Mm-hmm. So if we start to aware in the first place, things will, you know, you know, if you do good in the first, let's say if you do your job, if you're doing it good since the first place, you won't have much problem for the next level or whatever. Mm-hmm. So it's similar like that. That's what we teach each other in Theravada Buddhism.
Mm.
So
okay. So what do you mean by the next level? Like you won't have, if you are aware of what you're doing now.
Yep.
Then you know you're aware of your thoughts.
Yep.
You're aware of the behaviors that are coming from the thoughts.
Right.
And then you say you won't have a problem in the next level. What do you mean by next level?
Let's say if you have like a today. Let's say if you have, you set up the goal.
Mm-hmm.
You're gonna talk to somebody, and then you probably like have some problem in your mind. Like maybe some frustrating whatever. If you're not aware of it when set. Like constantly those person come to you and you know say something nice to you maybe a little bit, that's gonna lead, you know, from a little problem can be to the huge and big problem. That's some kind of awareness that how can I say that's actually the purpose of doing meditation and awaken.
To awaken so that we can live our lives better.
Yeah,
so
but it doesn't always work in that way. I honestly say that because myself, sometimes I have big problem with this kind of thing, even though I lived as a monk and doing meditation for many, many years. So
there's always challenges.
Yeah, always challenges.
Always challenges. I know what you mean. Yeah, of course. So, everyone has challenges.
Yeah.
But what you were saying is very interesting to me about waking up to live our lives better. We wake up to be more aware of our thoughts and our bodies and what we're doing, you know, our actions,
right.
and how our actions lead to consequences. And it's a very worldly idea. Like it brings it into this life, you know. I've heard some people talk about awakening as something almost awakening to something like out of this world, like people use the word God, or people use the word like shunyata, like nothingness, or everything, Brahman, and you know, these are different religions that describe different things.
Right.
I mean, in your experience, in you know, Theravada and Lao, is there a focus on that as part of awakening, or is awakening just awakening into this life, into this mind, into this behaviors?
Yeah, you know, in our Theravada Buddhism, we mostly focus on present moment, like I said before. Mm-hmm. So we truly believe that there's next life, next purpose. Like we also believe in reincarnation, but so next life, so this life will apply to the next life. So in that case, we take each other like to awareness on this life first, like doing good, behave properly, and when you pass away, you will go to heaven, or when you reincarnate for the next life, you will be in good shape, or you know, nice people, have many friends, to be born in a rich family. So. But yeah, like I said before, mostly it's all about this life, present moment. So if you do good here, it will be good in the future. If you do it good now, the next life, it will be good. That's what we believe. So
there's no real talk. People don't really talk about the shunyata, like emptiness, or like the nothingness and everything, oneness.
Well, we do talk about that, but in order to reach that point or that level, you have, there are so many steps to get through, like this life you're doing good things in this level, and the next life what else we're gonna do, and the next so yeah, since we believe like there are thousands of times that you'll have a chance to reincarnate, like whatever you're gonna be the next life, like it can be animal or human or God, whatever.
Yeah.
And then until you will reach them, the emptiness, like Buddha, Nirvana, that's what we call.
Mm-hmm.
So nothing. So it will, like, there are lots of things to get through to that point.
That's very interesting. So it sounds like what you're saying is that there's awakened, like you can be awake in life now,
mm-hmm, yeah,
but also not have reached Nirvana yet. Is that about right? Like that you can be awake now, mm-hmm, and be awake with your aware of your thoughts and your behaviors, but then Nirvana is a whole other level that comes after a lot of work.
Right, because recently, the world of technologies, people somehow at some point people want something, you know. People do awake, but there's something that people always wanted, not always money or material things. But in Buddhism, what we teach others, in order to reach Nirvana or emptiness, you will you free up nothing, no anger, no need of luxury life like money, gold, anything that can be, how can I say? You'll be free of, how can I say?
You just come closer because the sound over there is very loud.
So you have to be free of all kinds of things like anger, the need of want something else more, like materials, money, or whatever.
Yeah.
But since right now is the world of, you know, new technology, that there are so many attractions that leads people to the way that never ends. So not many people, I think not even one in million. That's what I believe. Mm-hmm. And
Not one in a million reach the Nirvana is what you're saying?
I totally believe in that way right now. But in the past, you know, everything was, there's nothing, right?
Uh-huh.
No vehicles, money, gold, whatever, almost not important. So people care much about each other. So people had no need purchase something that never end.
Mm.
So back in those times, like let's say Buddha's time, there was such different world right now, so people can easily get, you know, more calm, I can say, laid back.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that's one of the reasons that can make people reach, you know, Nirvana quickly than recent.
And so you think it's harder now for people to get to that point because of all the technology?
Because there's so many attractions.
And it pulls us in all directions.
Yeah.
And that makes it harder to be awake also, do you think?
Very hard.
Yeah. It makes it hard to be awake too.
You and myself.
Yeah. Yeah, no, hard. Yeah. It's for everyone, you know? It's a very difficult challenge. So I want to make to be clear, because that's what the point of this is, to get clarity. So basically I'm trying to figure out what's the difference between these things, awakening, enlightenment, Nirvana, you know? Would you say that those three things are different? You know, awakening, enlightenment, Nirvana?
I think Nirvana and enlightenment are almost the same, but awakening is different. Uh-huh. Awakening, that means you don't have to be you don't have to reach Nirvana. Awakening can happen to all of us, like me or you as human person can have that thought as well. So like we talked before, awakening is to realize, to aware, to behave properly and be careful about what you're gonna applies to other people. So this can have all human beings have this part, but to reach enlightenment and then the next level is Nirvana, that's different story. So
so can you maybe you can't describe it from personal experience, but Could you give me an idea of what enlightenment and nirvana are in your tradition?
Yeah. Well, in our Theravada Buddhism, enlightenment means you free from suffering. Like we have a four noble truths. Like I forgot how to say in English. Like you're free from suffering, free from any kinds of thought. You're free from any kinds of need. So you can live with very simple and happy and focus on inner inner peace. That's what we teach each other. And then when you, that's the enlightenment. And then when you reach nirvana, that means, okay, I no longer need anything at all. So next life, I'll be free. So no reincarnation, just emptiness. Huh. That's so, what we learn from.
The enlightenment is being free from suffering, yeah. And then nirvana is like being not needing anything at all.
Emptiness.
And the emptiness.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. And does that mean that when you're awake, you're not necessarily free from suffering? You can be awake but have suffering at the same time.
Yes. Yeah. I really believe that. Sometimes, let's say from my experience, sometimes when I focus on myself, when I was focused on myself about what I'm doing right now. I truly awake, but still, when problems comes in mind, let's say my family have problem, call me. Mm-hmm. I still have some suffering, even though I'm awake at the same time. Mm-hmm. So, yeah.
Huh. But if you were in a state of nirvana or enlightenment, then when you got the call from your family, you would still be totally no suffering.
Yeah, you will let it go. Like, okay, that's the life. That's the reality of the nature. So problems just come and go, so just, you know, you'll find a way that you'll let it free, set it free, let it go, and make yourself in peace and happy. That's what we learned.
Hmm. That's very, very cool, very interesting. I'm glad that you have a lot of clarity and a lot of, you speak good English, and that
Thank
was very
you.
Helpful.
So yeah, so I just want to make clear that since Buddhism, there are many different kinds of Buddhism, but we divide it into main part like Mahayana, Theravada, and the other one, I forgot it. So,
Vajrayana.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All kinds of Buddhism have different ideas on these things, but not really different, but some kind of similar, this kind of thing. But yeah, in terms of our Theravada Buddhism, that's how we teach it. How we teach each other.
Cool. And then this Theravada Buddhism is a specific Lao style, or what kind of style is it?
It's like the same in Sri Lanka, Thailand, and Cambodia, and in Myanmar. Uh-huh. So we are completely different from the one in Tibet or in China.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah.
So it's a Theravada, and do you have like a specific master that you follow, like somebody that started this lineage?
You mean back in the time?
Yeah, back
in the past. Well, we in Theravada Buddhism, we believe that we follow the real Buddha.
Oh, yeah.
And Mahayana Buddhism also believe that they got the real one.
Yeah.
So, technically, we don't really know who's the real one that set this kind of philosophy or religions. But we truly believe that we follow the Buddha's step, and also the, you know,
yeah,
Buddhism in other countries also that believe that they also follow the Buddha's step, but I don't know exactly why is it different, and who makes it different. You know, like story, let's say, if something happened to one person, when people talk, people always add it up, so extend it, you know, make a story longer. So I truly believe that this religion, in the past, they must become from the same person, like the Buddha, one Buddha, and then people will, you know, make it, okay, I have my idea, I'll change it a little bit, and those people, okay, I'll change it a little bit. So that's what I think the difference comes from.
Yeah, yeah, cool. Well, thank you so much for being here and talking to us.
You're welcome.
It was,
thank you for having me.
Very good conversation. I think it will make a good part of the documentary. Just, I want to get on video because we usually have forms that people sign, but right now, just can you say, like, okay, you can use this footage, like, Kevin, you can use this footage to make the documentary? That way, just we have permission.
Okay, so, well, since this is the something that we practice and we learned from here in Laos, you definitely can use this as the documentary or if there's something else that you're in your idea that you might add it on. So that would be perfect.
Thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome.
Bye. I really appreciate it. Yeah.